Sports bettors, are you ready? When you bet with PointsBet, you get faster bets, faster withdrawals, and faster rewards. Download the app now and sign up with code NBCPOD100 to get two risk-free bets up to $2,000. Terms and conditions apply. Void where prohibited. Must be 21 years or older. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER for crisis counseling and referral services.
Hey, Mike, good to see you, as usual.
What up?
And I have to say, what's going on is I know we will get back to the business of making fun of each other. I see you have some things in your feed that I'm taking quite personally. We can get to that. We'll get to that a little later. We'll have our laughs and that type of thing. But today I really want to start off with something that's been on my mind, and it's been on my mind for a long time, not just the last 10 months, but probably has been on my mind for the last 40 plus years. And that's just the state of things in the United States of America, more specifically, this opening day of Derek Chauvin's trial. I like the way you put it there. I was saying earlier it was the George Floyd trial, but really it's the trial of Derek Chauvin, who has been charged, three different counts of murder, one of manslaughter, second-degree murder, and another one. And then there's another charge for Derek Chauvin, who, everyone knows by now, for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, this 19-year police officer, this veteran of the police force, 19 years, so he knows better, 8 minutes and 46 seconds, kneeled on the neck of George Floyd. What's that?
9:29.
Oh, we've changed it from 8:46 to 9:29.
The time was wrong. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's 9 minutes and 29 seconds, something? To be more precise. Yeah.
Even worse than we thought. And Mike, this case weighs on me. For the case itself and for the dialogue around it. The one thing I put in the feed, I said, reckoning. Well, let's start with justice. Because we get a little high-minded. We start talking about reckoning in the United States of America. Reckoning can mean all sorts of things. And it's really dishonest. We can't go from the high chair in terms of racial understanding. You can't go from the high chair to Howard University in 10 months. You can't do that. We need to start talking about justice before we get to a reckoning. But I digress a little bit. I want to stay on track here and say that I was reading some stories on this over the weekend, and one of the things that stood out to me, there was a Minneapolis pastor who said, people are really nervous about this trial because we've seen this movie before. That was his quote. We've seen this movie before. Yes. Yes, we have.
What I've been saying since the beginning.
This movie is a combination of Groundhog Day and the classic Gaslight, where you're being told something's not happening, but that very thing is happening. And your mind is being messed with. Your intelligence is being consulted. You're being told that, hey, this is not it. 2 + 2 = 4. The sky is not blue. You're being told all these things. Your experience tells you that, yes, they are true, but somebody's trying to tell you something different. That has been the case. That's why I said it's been on my mind for 40 plus years. And I'll say this. The reason it really strikes me today is because I hope, don't expect. I'm not optimistic. I'm hopeful. There's a difference. I'm hopeful that it doesn't remind me of a movie that I experienced in 1992. I was a few weeks away from my college graduation. I remember being in my apartment on Mount Washington in Pittsburgh. I had three roommates. One of my roommates is a staunch conservative. To this day, one of my best friends, love him to death, but we rarely agreed on anything. So the Rodney King verdict came out that night.
Yeah.
Rodney King beaten 56 times in 81 seconds by four Los Angeles police department officers. That had happened the year before, but the acquittal of those officers led to LA going up in flames, truly going up in flames. Mm-hmm. And there were protests throughout the country. We were in Pittsburgh, and my staunch conservative roommate had a baseball bat and wanted to go to the streets and do something. Because his sense of justice, it was an affront to his sense of justice. This was not about politics for him. This was about right and wrong. And we know what happened. The right thing did not happen in 1992. And we had some of the same language. Oh, it's time for a reckoning. We got to get better. We're better than this. This is not who we are, on and on and on and on, et cetera, et cetera. And I look at it now, in 2021, I know we're not ready for a reckoning. And I'm already nervous. Looking at some of the comments from the jurors, we don't know their names yet. Let's say we'll go by the numbers. There's juror 85. And this is really the crux of the issue. And I wish I could make people understand, people who haven't experienced it, I wish I could make them understand it, but they just, is it a lack of understanding? Is it a lack of empathy? Is it a combination? I don't know. Ignorance, willful ignorance? I don't know. But juror number 85 says, hey, I'm a working mom. And I think that police officers make mistakes, can make some mistakes. Mm-hmm. But here's the key. If you don't do what police officers say, essentially, if you don't do what you tell them, if you don't do what they tell you to do.
If you don't comply.
Listen. If you don't do what they tell you to do, you basically get what you deserve. So that's one of the jurors. That is not a potential juror. She's a juror on this trial, as part of this trial. And I got to tell you, like, this is the last thing I'll say, and I'll kick it to you. Now, by observation, by experience, anecdotes, my life experience, film, fiction, there's so many examples where this doesn't happen. Like, we both know, we've talked about this before. You know, Richard Pryor had this whole comedy bit about being pulled over by the police and saying, I am reaching for the glove compartment. I don't want there to be any mistakes. You know, he's making a big joke about it. But as he was talking about the difference between the difference of a black person being pulled over and a white person being pulled over by cops. But more than that, one of the biggest arguments I've ever had with a white friend of mine was over his driving. He was in the car. He was driving the car. I was in there with another friend of ours who's black. He got pulled over. He was so disrespectful. White guy. So disrespectful to the cops. I mean, just like cutting them off, shutting them down, the whole thing. He was speeding. He was wrong, but he didn't want to admit that. He was wrong. He was speeding. He's disrespectful. He just said, we'll see. We'll see what happens. Okay. All right. What'd you clock me with? What'd you use? Oh, how do you know that? And I'm looking at my boy. We're looking at each other like, man, he's putting us in jeopardy. He's putting us in jeopardy. But the kicker is he was disrespectful. We drove off, no problem. And on the same day, he's got bad timing. This is what really affected our friendship. He's got bad timing. On the same day that Mike Brown was killed in Ferguson, Missouri, he sent both of us and who were in the car, he sent both of us a text saying, justice. Justice was served. I'm like, what are you talking about? My ticket. I got my ticket taken care of. I don't have to pay anything. Mm. Like, we've seen this before. Don't tell me that a condition of dealing with the police is that you must be respectful to the police. Should you? Yes, you should. But you mean to tell me that everybody in this country, more specifically, you mean to tell me the white people in this country are always respectful with the police? And if they are disrespectful,
of course
they
not.
Wind up dead?
Of course not.
So I'm very...
That's a low threshold.
I mean, I'm very nervous.
When mass murderers are taken alive, but I'm sorry, I don't mean that.
Mass murderers taken alive.
Go ahead.
January 6th, the Capitol.
Taking the Burger King, as the case may be.
We've seen so many examples. You remember the film example? Remember Get Out? When Allison Williams' character, the police officer says, "Hey, can I see your license?" Like, what are you talking about? No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, you're not getting the license. Hey, he wasn't driving. She drives off. Is that fiction? Is that life imitating art? Is that art imitating life? I say it's both. I'm nervous about this. I hope it's as simple as what it is. What it is 9 minutes and 29 seconds, a police officer who should have known better, who didn't necessarily go there to murder George Floyd, but once he got there, he couldn't stop himself from murdering George Floyd, is brought to justice. That's what it's about. It's not about Republicans and Democrats. It's not about conservatives and liberals. It's not about being apolitical, highly political. It's not about Black Lives Matter. It is about justice. And if justice is not served, then we should probably just tone down our chatter, tone down our rhetoric, our high-minded rhetoric, because we're not ready for it.
Yeah, it's never that simple with us. By the way, maybe we'll get to this later on. Did you see episode 2 of The Falcon and the Winter Soldier?
I didn't see episode 2.
Did you watch episode 2 yet?
No, not 2.
Man. No. All right. Not to derail a conversation.
No, go ahead. Again. Bring that up. Introduce.
Because I don't want to. Oh, okay. All right.
Things are not spoiled for me.
But we can't have the conversation. It's not about spoiling it. We can't have the conversation I want to have if you haven't seen it. That's like talking about a book that both of us haven't read. I mean, I guess we can talk about it in general, but you're not going to appreciate the fact that you just referenced the scenario from Get Out of art imitating life, imitating art, that literally plays out in the second episode of Falcon and the Winter Soldier when Bucky and Sam are confronted by police and they ask for Sam's ID, whether Sam is bothering Bucky. But anyway, I'm not nervous, Michael, because nerves come with uncertainty. And I am certain as to how this is going to play out. We've seen this movie before, and therefore we know how this movie ends. It is just a matter of how we're going to arrive at that inevitable, yet no less disappointing conclusion. Then again, I say disappointing, and disappointment is in direct correlation with expectations, and I expect nothing more from the criminal justice system in this country than to acquit Officer Derek Chauvin, who, by the way, and I don't really care about his name at this point, I've heard 3 different pronunciations today of his name. I've heard Chauvin, I've heard Chauvin, I've heard Shaven. I'm pretty sure it's Chauvin, but I'm not in the mood to be respectful toward the pronunciation of his name. Normally that kind of thing would bug me or irk me or be in the back of my mind, like, I want to get his name right. I don't give a damn about his name. The murderer. As expected, the defense stuck to the script and sticking with the movie analogy. The defense stuck with the script, and that script says that the villain is the victim, that the villain is George Floyd, that George Floyd was a criminal who tried to use a counterfeit $20 bill and therefore he deserved to die, that George Floyd was non-compliant and therefore he deserved to die, that George Floyd was big and strong and menacing
and black.
And hopped up on drugs, and therefore his death was inevitable, and he brought it upon himself, and poor Derek Chauvin and his colleagues were simply doing their job, and it's a difficult job, and it's a dangerous job, and they just wanted to go home to their families. And so what my expectation is, you mentioned the jurors, there's no way they're going to get 12 jurors to convict Derek Chauvin beyond a reasonable doubt of any of those charges, let alone all three of them. They ain't getting him on second degree murder. They ain't getting him on third degree murder. They're not getting him on manslaughter. Not all 12, because all it takes is one. All it takes is one to not see the video the way that the rest of us see it, that the way that reasonable people see it. All it takes is one to see the video the way the defense needs him to see it, which was that George Floyd did not die because he was strangled, because he was kneeled on for 9 minutes and 29 seconds. George Floyd died because he was on drugs, which that script is believable. It's like in sports. When you have something in your playbook, it's in your playbook because it works, or it's worked enough for it to stay in your playbook. Right. That script is tried and true, even if the narrative is false. Let me say that again. That script, that playbook is tried and true, even if the narrative is false. So the defense went to the predictable route in its opening statements and saying, listen, a tragedy happened, but that's not why he died. He died because he had drugs in the system. Oh, black man on drugs? That sells. Just as black man or black woman, as the case may be, as threat always sells. I feared for my life always sells. Even if we are unarmed, that always sells. That's always believable. And so they went that route as expected. They went the route of, you know, his death was brought on by some underlying condition as opposed to being strangled. And again, had he just complied, had he just done what he would, had he not tried to use a counterfeit $20 bill, allegedly, had he not failed to comply, then we wouldn't be here. So it's, I mean, and Michael, it's so universal. It's women have to not be raped. They have to do the work to not be raped. They have to do the work to not be abused.
What were you wearing?
Yeah.
Right.
You know, were you watching your drink? Did you go to his room? They have to be the one. Right. The onus is on them to not be raped. The onus is on black people to not be killed. There was a moment, I was pretty locked into it today. There was a moment with the 911 dispatcher was actually the first witness. And they played her tape. They played the recording of her calling the sergeant, who was a supervisor for Derek Chauvin and the rest of the officers on the scene. And I really wish the prosecution would have unpacked this a little bit more. And I guess I get why, because the prosecution made it a point to say this is not a trial about all police. This is not about policing in America. This is about the events of May 25th, 2020, Derek Chauvin, George Floyd, that fateful and fatal encounter. That's all this is about. But that's not realistic. This is about policing. This is about the culture of policing. And there was one moment that I really wish the prosecution would have unpacked a little bit more, because I think it would have spoken to the issue that's really at hand here, and that's the culture around policing and how we often work harder to protect police than a lot of police work to protect us.
Yeah.
And what she said in her call is the first thing out of her mouth to the sergeant. One of the first things out of her mouth. Did you hear this? She said, call me a snitch if you want. First thing she said, call me a snitch if you want. But something's happening out there and it ain't right. Like, why was her instinct to qualify what she was about to say with, listen, I know this is not kosher. I know this is protocol.
Not part of our,
I know we don't typically tell on one another.
We don't do this.
It's not, you know, we don't do this. Call me a snitch if you want, but something that stinks is going on. I'm watching it play out on video right now. I really wish they would unpack that a little bit more, because that speaks volumes about what this is and where we are and where this is going to end up. Because they're not going to get 12 people to convict a police officer. We hold them in too high a regard.
They haven't.
We talk about nobody's above the law. I'll be damned. The police, the people who protect and serve or who are assigned to protect and serve, the police are above the law in this country. And even if by some sheer miracle, they actually manage to convict Derek Chauvin, even if this actually happens against all the evidence to the contrary throughout this country's history, how much of a deterrent is it going to be? How much of a statement is it really going to make? Because justice is balanced. There is no true justice for George Floyd being murdered. There is no true justice, neither criminal nor civil, for George Floyd being murdered. There are consequences. Are those consequences for the suspect? all those consequences for Derek Chauvin going to serve as some kind of a deterrent for the next officer who enters the situation and handles it according to that double standard you outlined earlier, handles it according to that double standard and exerts deadly force on a black man or woman? And it's not just life or death. I keep saying that police brutality is the tip of the iceberg. It is the extreme manifestation of systemic racism in the United States of America. Because there are our lives being taken, meanwhile our livelihoods and our rights to liberty and the pursuit of happiness, again, we're fixated on life. Life is the thing that gets people in the streets. Liberty and the pursuit of happiness, there continue to be bill after bill and legislation after legislation signed and passed restricting voting rights. So black lives and black livelihoods both matter. And so I guess it's like, I hate, would it be a victory if Derek Chauvin is convicted? Yes. But I'm not sure it will be some watershed moment that would truly. The Senate still has not passed the George Floyd Policing Act.
Yeah. And you're right. You're right.
So is it exactly watershed? What will we get out of this? I don't think it's something that's going to. I don't think it's going to signify some kind of a sea change, no more than the video in the ensuing summer of protests. What did that really change?
Right.
I'm not sure.
Right. And we talked about it. We talked about it a lot. You know, protests, global protests, and companies, corporations saying Black Lives Matter, and people saying we gotta do better than this. Look at the construction of our or the composition of our boards. Look at our employees. Look at what we're doing. Are we doing enough? Yeah. Okay. Those are short term responses to something that everybody was talking about in May. In the first couple of months of the pandemic, because we didn't know a lot of things at that time. We didn't know that the pandemic would continue to go on. We didn't know what would happen in the presidential election. January 6th hadn't happened. I mean, there are so many things we just didn't know. We couldn't, couldn't see the future. So now here we are, almost in April of 2021. Is that same passion, is that same commitment, is that same sense of righteousness and justice, is that in our chest like it was in May and June of 2020? Doesn't sound like it, Mike, because you want to talk about the playbook. I'll tell you another thing about the playbook is just acting as if there's some perfect person out there. There's some perfect person who encounters police. We're all broken, including the police officer. We're all broken to some degree. So we all have some flaws.
Sorry about that.
That we're leaving the house with every day. So to bring up the counterfeit $20 bill, sure. Okay, should he have had $20 counterfeit bill? No, but that's not the point. It goes back to
Trayvon, once upon a time.
Remember with Trayvon? Yeah. The whole thing with Trayvon. Well,
yeah.
He's not the choir boy. The media, the liberal media has made him out to be. No, he's a child who has not matured, who has not grown into himself. What does that have to do with anything?
Once upon a time, in the age of respectability politics, once upon a time, there was this notion that if we presented ourselves better, that would prove us worthy of being viewed equally. And then even further down the line, once upon a time, there was a notion that, well, if you had anything in your past, if you got caught with weed in high school or anything like that, that we had to be perfect, that our character was going to be put on trial, or they would use that as some kind of a rationale as to, well, Mike Brown was really a criminal, or Trayvon Martin was really a thug, so on and so forth. But Michael, it's been proved time and time again that even if you are perfect, even if you are upstanding, it doesn't matter. Yeah. When that moment of truth arrives, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. You know? I bit my tongue just now. Wow.
No,
I
well,
actually
guys,
succeeded
I'm glad,
in biting my tongue.
I'm glad you did. I'm glad you did. You know, think about it. Do a little reframing. Do a little reframing and come back to that. But I do want to point out that another thing I don't want to hear anymore is we have to stop calling ourselves a Judeo-Christian nation, a Christian nation. No, we're not. We're not. You know, I don't know if you remember this story right after George Floyd. Now, I don't know. You know, Mike, you lived in Boston for a while in the Boston area. For what, 10 years? 12 years? What was it? You lived here
Something
for a while.
Something like that, yeah.
Actually, I don't know if you heard. MIT, yeah, pretty MIT, pretty good school, right? MIT?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Pretty good school. Supposed to be the best of the best. The brightest minds. Well, there was a chaplain at MIT who lost his job right after the death of George Floyd because this man of God decided to tell everybody that, and he wrote this in an email to MIT students and professors, that George Floyd didn't live a life that was worthy of God. I mean, he was a, you know, they're making a big deal about this stuff. He had a past. He had some dirt on him. So why are we talking this way? As if, Mike, everybody in the Bible, except for Jesus, didn't have a past.
Yeah.
David, Paul, Moses, murder.
Wow, I like
adultery.
I like
rape. Come on.
We can just call ourselves. America just call itself what it is and call it a hypocritical country. I've said, listen, you know, we're up against it, and maybe we'll come back to it later in the show. But as we go into break, Michael, I'll say the same thing I said when Breonna Taylor, when they did not say her name, and they were reading the charges, just prove us wrong just once. Prove us wrong. I mean, like, we don't enjoy being skeptical. It's not fun. It's not fun knowing how the movie ends. It's not fun knowing how the story ends. It's not fun expecting for there to be unequal justice under the law. So I love to be proved wrong. I love it if at the end of this trial there was a guilty verdict. But even then, like I said earlier, I'm not going to celebrate because it'll be one cop will have gotten the conviction and the punishment that he deserves. The next cop ain't going to be thinking about Derek Chauvin when it comes time to pull that trigger or when it comes time to administer that chokehold. How much of it, is it actually a deterrent? I don't think so. But that's all I got for now. I mean, yeah. If you have anything you want to add,
no.
We could go ahead and catch our breath and take a break.
Yeah, I'm going to go, I'll bite my tongue too. You know, just take a little break from this.
The Podium, an Olympic podcast from NBC, will bring you deep into the stories and events that have defined the game's past and will define the Tokyo Games. But we'll also give you an intimate look into the unseen details that only the athletes themselves can tell.
I'm sitting in these giant inflated boots that come up your butt.
My grandma tends to hoard the medals and the trophies.
That's something that will just automatically get you stopped by airport security is, what's in your bag? Oh, it's a gold medal.
Tune in for weekly episodes wherever you listen to podcasts.
So over the weekend, LaMarcus Aldridge shocked us by signing with the Brooklyn Nets. A lot of people had him ticketed for the Miami Heat. And so he joins the already loaded Nets. And Michael, I was reading this on NBCSports.com earlier. Our guy Dan Feldman pointed out that the Nets are the first team in NBA history with six players who've already made multiple All-NBA teams. Durant, Harden, Blake Griffin, LaMarcus Aldridge, DeAndre Jordan, Kyrie Irving. They've combined for 31 All-NBA appearances. Only the 04 Lakers, and I'm going to come back to that, who had 38 among Malone, Shaq, Peyton, and Kobe, and the 2011 Celtics, who had 32 among Shaq, K, KG, Paul Pierce, Jermaine O'Neal, and Ray Allen had more all-NBA selections in prior seasons. So here's what's interesting. None of the four teams with at least 30 all-NBA selections have won a championship.
Right.
And among the 13 teams with more than 25 all-NBA selections, only two won a title. And that two includes the 72 Lakers because their number includes Elgin Baylor's 10 all-NBA selections. But as we know, he retired during that season.
Right.
Yeah, he retired during that season.
Coincidence?
And
is that
so,
a coincidence?
No, because the reason that those teams rarely win a title, in order to accumulate that many all-NBA selections, you got to be kind of old. Right. So nonetheless, this is a big deal. A buyout, but a big deal for L.A. to go to BK. And I just want to extend, Michael, to you an invitation. I've been saving a seat. It's a little crowded. It's a little tight. We might. It's not exactly socially distant at this point, okay? It'll be our elbows will be touching. It'll be some skin to skin. Hope you don't mind, because you've been waiting kind of long. But I've been trying to save you some room. This seat is taken. I've been telling people, hey, is somebody sitting there? Nope. I'm holding this for somebody. I'm inviting you onto the bandwagon. There is still time. Because there are enough haters out there, because we saw that over the weekend. There are plenty enough haters out there to where there's still space on this Nets bandwagon. So you could just put the little Baptist finger up, excuse yourself from the congregation with the Sixers, and come on over to this championship chase here with the Brooklyn Nets. I'm just letting you know. Yes. I am making a big deal of LaMarcus Aldridge off the buyout market. Not because LaMarcus Aldridge is the thing that puts him over the top. It's that LaMarcus Aldridge.
But it sounds like.
And before him, Blake Griffin.
Like you're saying that.
No. Because he's a role player. And Claxton should play more center anyway. I mean, he just gives him another option. I mean, let's not get carried away here.
This is not
peak LaMarcus Aldridge. This is not peak Blake Griffin. But Blake talked about it early, and it's kind of hilarious. Everybody in their feelings and everybody mad. And Blake said it earlier today. For the last 2 years, I've been hearing how terrible I was. It's like everybody getting all upset, like they got jumping over key of Blake Griffin. Like they got LaMarcus Aldridge when he was dropping 50 in the playoffs. That's not who they just got. They were already locked and loaded for a championship, and I tried to told you, when they assembled this big three. What they've done a brilliant and masterful job of is replenishing the depth that they sacrificed to get James Harden in the first place. So those questions about their depth are no longer, at least on offense. Defensively, neither Blake nor LaMarcus helps in defensively. They got to play Claxton, when it really comes time to stop people as best they can. But offensively, they got even more guys that can get points and experience guys that can get you points in big spots come playoff time.
All right, look.
So,
first of all, thank you for the offer.
Light yet or not?
I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
No, I appreciate the offer.
Hold it as long as I can.
I appreciate it. Appreciate the offer, and I appreciate the question. no, the offer is great. And if you said it's not socially distant, look, I know a lot of people right now have COVID fatigue. Even with the vaccine, you got to wear a mask. I'm not going to get ahead of myself. I'm not jumping on some crowded bandwagon even with the vaccine floating out there. So I'm going to pass on that. Thank you very much. In all seriousness, I'm going to ask you. Now, you mentioned you just kind of glossed over the most important thing about the Brooklyn Nets, their biggest flaw, and that is their inability to lock you down and lock you up defensively. When it turns into a half-court game, and it will, right now it's great. Right now it's great. You know, regular season. They're putting up, their offensive rating. James Harden is this, James Harden is that, and he thinks he's the MVP. Thanks, James, for your humility. So he thinks he's the MVP in the league, no question, period. But in the playoffs, for them to win a championship, they will have to defend consistently, not just for a stop or two. They're going to have to consistently defend. Yeah, championship. Let me ask you a question.
Yep.
When's the last team? Who's the last championship team that couldn't? Show me the last championship team.
Well, none of them couldn't. No, that's never happened.
Where
a championship team just couldn't. There's a stat, and I don't have it in front of me, and I don't memorize. I apologize. But there's a certain threshold in terms of ranking that few, if any, teams have ever gone below to win a championship. It might be something like 11th. Maybe it's something crazy. And maybe last year's Lakers might have been one of the exceptions in terms of regular season defensive rating. I don't want to butcher that. But yeah, to your point, historically, you have to at least reach a certain level of defensive competence to win a championship. This team would break that mold. They've improved substantially over the course of the season.
Defensively. Yes, they have.
Enough to offset what is potentially, but see, here's the thing. All right, you're right. No team has ever won it not being able to defend. Also, no team has ever had this kind of firepower. When Durant's healthy, when he returns, nobody's had this. Nobody's had this.
You just told me.
No, I did not point it out. I said the accumulation of all NBA selections on teams that were old. I mentioned the 2011 Celtics and Shaq. I mentioned the people who were decorated in terms of accomplishments for their careers. The 04 Lakers didn't have this kind of firepower. They just had what was left of Karl Malone and Gary Payton. They didn't have MVP James
Kobe,
Harden.
And, I don't know. Just and Kobe still and Shaq. Prime. I might take Kobe and Shaq. I might take Kobe and Shaq over their regular big three. I might take those two over those three.
At least you said might. Okay, and we can have that debate. But Kevin Durant, James Harden, and Kyrie Irving are a trio offensively unlike any we've ever seen, arguably. And there have been some other big threes throughout NBA history, lots of big threes. But this trio is different. The defensive question remains about the playoffs. Why? Because we haven't gotten to the playoffs yet. But this team, I maintain, only has to be okay on defense to complement and supplement what they bring on offense.
I'm going to tell you right now. Please. Don't say I didn't tell you. In March.
Oh, I won't March have to say that. I won't have to say that.
I'm just telling you right now.
If they falter in March, I am fully prepared.
No.
I'm not even, Michael, if they falter in March. No. I got you. I got this.
No. If they
falter in the playoffs, excuse me. It doesn't matter what you're going to say. If they falter in the playoffs, I'm going to come in, and you see this right here? You see this? I'm not even going to bother putting this on. I'm not even going to put this on. I'm just going to sit here, and I'm going to take it. I'm fully prepared to take it. I'm going to take all the smoke. I'm okay with that. I'm okay. If they falter in the playoffs, I'm going to just sit here like a grown man, I will show up.
Especially
I'll be here.
If they get upset.
I'll be here. I'll be ready for it.
If they get a – if it's like the a couple of examples. Bruh. Like Denver, Seattle, Golden State, Dallas. You know, one of those 1-8. One of those monumental
if they struggle. If they fall behind, don't let them fall behind. Don't let them lose the series, game one. If they lose game one, if they fall down 2-1, 3-1, you're gonna be warming up.
Attention at 3-1.
I'm ready. You remember when
I'm good on one.
You remember when we were newspaper guys? And you as a columnist, of course. It was just unwritten rule. Like you had to, you write something, you got to show up the next day. Even if you weren't writing or reporting, or you might have been off the next day, you just got to show up and just stand in the locker room in case somebody wanted a piece of you. That's how we came up. We came up in those days. You know, it was like, okay, I wrote something. I wrote some commentary, maybe a little controversial. I'm here if anybody wants to discuss.
I'm here
in person.
You want something?
You know,
this
is pre-internet days. This is before you can just write something from 1,000 miles away and never have to. You know,
don't have to worry about
accountable.
Yeah, to accountability. Don't have to worry about
somebody stepping to you.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, so I'm gonna be accountable if my Brooklyn Nets do not come through in the postseason. I won't ever say you told me so. You won't give me a chance to say you told me so because I won't get a word in edgewise.
All right, listen.
And that's okay.
As an aside,
and I'll deserve it, and I will deserve it.
As an aside, don't you feel a little uncomfortable riding for the Brooklyn Nets? Now, Brooklyn, I didn't say New Jersey. The Brooklyn Nets who have tried to
Why do you ask?
They don't really have a footprint. Their fans, I don't really know what their fans stand for. It's the Brooklyn Nets. They're just so temporary. A temporary team. And they don't really have any passionate tradition. So
because they're not the Celtics or the Lakers or the history.
Or the 76ers. Or the Bucks. Or even the Magic. Even the Orlando Magic have a deeper fan base. I'm just saying, you're jumping on them. How do you feel good rooting for this team? Why are you rooting for this team? Why are you rooting for them? Tell me why. Is it James Harden?
Honestly? It's me. Yes, okay. Because of that. Because of people like you. This is full-on contrarian mode right now.
It's personal.
I'm enjoying all the people who think the NBA is broke. All the people who are in their feelings, all the people who are butthurt because they feel like the NBA is rigged and it's another
super NBA,
anti-super team people.
Maybe this doesn't apply to you.
Okay, good.
It didn't apply to me.
The rest of you.
But those guys are out there.
But those guys are out there. You'd acknowledge that, though, right? Those people are still out there, right?
Sure. Okay.
The haters.
Bring on another all-NBA player in his mid-30s. Go ahead and do it. I don't think it's unfair. I don't think Brooklyn, we might as well give a trophy to Brooklyn, right? No. I like seeing the collection of all these stars because I'm going to sit there in my straight-up hater game when they fail. I'm going to love it.
I see what you did there. Okay.
I'm just hating on them.
So you don't really like it. You like to hate on them. Yeah. You like it because it gives you something to hate on. It gives you a target. I got you.
Confession. Good for the soul, bad for the reputation. Okay. Let me just throw this out here. A couple guys on the team I just don't like. I'm working through it. I'm trying to work through it. Like Kevin Durant, has there ever been a more sensitive star player in the NBA? Is he the most sensitive star in the league in a generation? I mean, this is what I would do. We talked about social media the other day when the Chicago Bears had QB1 with Andy Dalton. And you said, hey, what are you trying to go with this? If I'm facing the Brooklyn Nets, what I'm doing, if I'm that team, I'm the opposing team, I'm getting my social media team to just troll him. I'll just troll him. Just throw out stuff. It doesn't have to be true. Throw out stuff about him. Attack him. Say, like, he's overrated. Say he shouldn't have left Golden State. All the stuff that bothers him. Say Steve Kerr preferred to coach a 15-50 team than coach Kevin Durant. He is bothered. He's not unbothered. He's bothered by so many little stuff. Little stuff just annoys him. Come on, man. Just play ball.
So can we park there? I know you want to go down the list of the people you don't like in this organization, but that's perfect. That's a perfect way to transition into. We'll get to him in a second because there's a lot to unpack there. But let's talk about Durant because Sunday morning, you know, he made some headlines. Because there was one Twitter user who tweeted, "I see you really can't lead a team on your own." And Durant replied, "I'll never be able to do anything that I really want to do on Earth by myself." And that's not the first time. I mean, look, he's had burner account. I don't even know if he uses a burner account now. Now it's just him. Now it's just KD Trey 5. I would like to see Kevin Durant save his energy. Because the people who drop snake emojis in the comments, the people who don't believe that Kevin Durant legitimately won two championships with the Warriors, and the people who believe that Kevin Durant took the easy route jumping from Oklahoma City after losing that 3-1 lead to the Warriors who had won 73 games without him, those people, he's never going to change their minds. For the same reason that many of us long ago stopped trying to convince racists of their racism or stop trying to convince. I mean, there's just certain people like they're just there to argue. They're just there for attention that Kevin Durant is happily providing them. They're not going to change their minds about Kevin Durant because he says, I'll never be able to do anything that I really want to do on this earth by myself.
Right.
Those people, you've lost them and you're never going to get them. There are certain people when it comes to all matters, whether it's race, gender, or Kevin Durant's legacy, they're never going to change their minds, no matter how many times you tweet them. It is this never-ending cycle of just tweets and retweets and who could run up the score or one-up somebody, right? And I've retired from that game long ago. And I wish Kevin Durant, who am I to tell him how to use his Twitter, as he said, but I wish he would save his energy. But I don't even think that's what it is for him at this point. I think he's just one of these dudes, and maybe we can't relate to it because we old. I think he enjoys it. I think he enjoys being regular. And I think those of us who look at him as, well, Kevin Durant, you're one of the greatest people to ever pick up a basketball. This should be beneath you. I think he's like, no, it's not beneath me.
No, I'm just a regular dude.
No. I want to do the same thing y'all do, and I want to clap back. Let me clap back. And I guess I'm like, okay, if that whatever floats your boat, bruh. But it's like, I just think for Kevin Durant, you are like you even correcting somebody that says you really can't lead a team on your own. Your response is not going to enlighten that person. It's just going to shine a spotlight on that person that they didn't otherwise deserve.
The reason, like Twitter is so interesting. Social media in general is interesting, particularly the responses.
I'm not saying be Chrissy Teigen and log off for life. I'm not saying delete your account, Kevin Durant.
And good for Chrissy Teigen.
I'm just saying.
Good for her. Smart.
No, for sure. Good for
great.
Hey, I love what she had to say. I love her rationale. I'm saying Kevin Durant can use Twitter how he wants. I just hope that he's not thinking that he's going to convince people or change people's hearts or minds one clap back at a time, because it ain't happening. People have made up their mind about him. And even though the fact is that LaMarcus Aldridge and Blake Griffin and James Harden want to play with him, and Kyrie Irving, they want to play with him, not the other way around. People are just going to look at it as though there's only one way for him to win a championship, and that's the hard way, the old-fashioned way. As if anybody in NBA history has ever won a championship with a bunch of bums.
Never. It's never happened.
Let's not let the facts get away with a good Twitter beef.
I would say with Kevin Durant, though, and a lot of people on social media, the reason it bothers you is because it's something they have able. When you respond to somebody, you got millions of followers like he does, and you respond to somebody who says something trifling, ratchet, whatever it is, it's because they have tapped. They have tapped on something that bothers
struck
you.
A nerve.
It bothers you. You can say anything you want. Hey, don't tell me how to use Twitter or. Like, you're responding because it bothers you. And so I don't think he is doing it. Hey, I like to be like.
Generally.
No. You know what? What taught me, show me everything. I mean, I have like 10 examples of Kevin Durant. One of the recent examples, Charles Barkley was very critical of him over the summer, of Durant.
Mm-hmm. We talk about what he didn't answer Charles. What is one word in Charles Barkley? But he was
He just sat there. He sat there and he pouted. And he pouted. Come on, man. Like, this is the thing. This is their, I don't know what's the bigger Achilles heel for the Brooklyn Nets? Kevin Durant's sensitivity or their defense? I don't know. It's hand in hand. It's 50-50. I'm trying to attack both.
I think they're mutually exclusive.
I'm trying to attack both on the Brooklyn Nets when I get into the playoffs.
But this sensitivity. Wait, let's discuss this. But see, that I got to disagree with you vehemently or violently, as the case may be.
Go ahead.
On that.
Violently disagree. Go ahead.
If you think that Kevin Durant's sensitivity, his rabbit ears, his Twitter activity, if you think that's going to be the Nets' undoing, you got another thing coming.
Okay, like, watch.
Kevin Durant, let me ask you a question. Kevin Durant ain't going to hear nothing now that he didn't hear when he went to the Warriors. Did that stop him from being the best player on the Golden State Warriors? See, here's the thing that his haters don't acknowledge. What they don't acknowledge is that they can add everybody under the sun. They can add everybody under the sun. Everybody under the sun, not named LeBron James. And Kevin Durant's the best player on the team. And some would say that even if they added LeBron James, Kevin Durant's the best player on the team. Some. I'm not one of them, but some. It's an argument. Point being, is that when he went to the Warriors, even though the Warriors won without him, he became the best player. And the Warriors will tell you that. No matter who the Nets, when he and Kyrie Irving went to the Nets, Kevin Durant's the best player. James Harden, one of the greatest offensive forces we've ever seen, comes to the Nets.
Kevin Durant's the best player. That's right.
Kevin Durant's the best player on the team. And what's interesting is how haters have different shifts that they take. Hating is a full-time job, so I've been told.
Is it?
And they have different shifts that they take. Because the same people.
How long is your typical Nets game? About 2.5 hours. I can do about 2.5 hours. I do about what? 7-8 hours a week.
I would love to. No more. I would love to. So King Ravi 101, the person who inspired, who elicited and solicited Kevin Durant's response. Ravi Mohani. King Ravi 101. I would love to go through his Twitter history and see if he kept that same energy when LeBron James got Anthony Davis, or when LeBron James went to Cleveland with Kyrie Irving and flipped Andrew Wiggins for Kevin Love. My point is, Michael, Kevin Durant is not guilty of any. He's guilty of nothing that any other superstar has done throughout NBA history. He just did it differently, and his timing was off. Why are you hating on him?
I'm not hating on
him. Why are you hating on
the Nets?
Why?
Because, as you said, championship teams always have great players. General manager.
All of them. Either the front office does it, or the players do it. What's the difference? Honestly, what's the difference? What did Michael Jordan win without Scottie Pippen?
I have not tweeted at Kevin Durant yet. I don't think I'll do that. At least not under my own account. It's a good idea, though. It's a good idea. See if I can get a good response. No, but in all seriousness, I think what people who don't like Kevin Durant, because I happen to like him very much, I think he's just unbelievable. He's like he's a great player. He reminds me of, now this is a Hall of Fame player I'm talking about. It's almost like he picked up the things. Look it up, boys and girls, if you don't know the name. He picked up all the things that Alex English didn't have in his game. So Alex English, Hall of Fame baller, could score mid-range score. So Kevin Durant took Alex English's game and then put it on steroids, figure of speech, put it on steroids and just became a complete offensive machine. And a little bit more height, about 3 or 4 inches on Alex English. So I appreciate who he is. I used to call Kevin Durant New English. Get that? New English. I like that. Anyway, this is what I don't like about him. And what his haters don't like about him. I'm kind of neutral on this. They were up 3-1, I believe, on Golden State. Right? 3-1?
Correct. Yes, they were.
Russell Westbrook. Kevin Durant. Mm-hmm. Harden was still there? No, Harden was gone. I think Harden was gone. But they're up 3-1 on Golden State. Mm-hmm. They lose that series, and he runs to Golden State. I mean, I get it. But it does, optically, it's questionable. You agree? It's just a little questionable. You could have beaten this team.
It was for me at the time. But and what was worse is that Russ took the fall for it as if Kevin Durant didn't have moments where he underperformed in that collapse. But it was all about, Russell Westbrook was holding him back. Wasn't holding you back from getting up 3-1 in the first place. So, no, that was unprecedented. But much like LeBron's decision, at a certain point, can we get over it? Like, when LeBron went to Miami, I remember tweeting, if LeBron joins Dwayne Wade's team, he should renounce his throne like Hakeem in the subway and Coming to America. He ain't the king no more if he goes and joins Dwayne Wade's team. But I was tripping back then. I've evolved. We could all evolve. I could change. You could change. Everybody could change. Okay? And it's like what I didn't allow for is that it wasn't when LeBron James went to Miami, it wasn't Dwayne Wade's team anymore. And Dwayne Wade figured that out. It was LeBron James' team. Likewise, with Kevin Durant, he jumped from a 3-1 collapse to the Warriors. The Warriors became Kevin Durant's team? Because if that's the case, then let's just start discrediting the Warriors for adding Kevin Durant in the first place. Oh, wait, I'm sure people actually do that. But like, okay, is it that Durant needed the Warriors, or did the Warriors need Durant, or both? And again, LeBron James ain't never won anything without a stacked team. All of LeBron's championships.
Exactly. No, it's different.
So why is Kevin Durant such a bad dude?
Two different arguments.
Are they? Enlighten me.
Look, I'm just saying. Now, this is not my position. I want to be clear, it's not my position, but I can see they're different categories.
But some people say it. A lot of people say it, though.
Not my position.
A lot of people say it.
No, man. I'm good with, hey, the 80s were the 80s. I enjoyed it. You heard me say the other day, best basketball is being played right now. This is the best the NBA has been in its entire history right now, 75 years. But the 80s, when you talk about Jordan, Jordan says, oh, yeah, I had talent on my team, but I didn't join Magic. I didn't join Bird.
He didn't have to.
I know I had help.
He didn't have to.
And I didn't leave.
He didn't have to.
That's the dividing line. Those who stayed.
But he didn't have to.
And those
who didn't have to.
I get it.
But they didn't have to.
It was a different league. It was different.
So why are you repeating somebody else's argument? You agree?
I'm clarifying, because you're arguing two different things. You're arguing, hey, everybody's got talent.
No, I'm not.
But I'm not.
But I'm not arguing two
what
different
things.
I'm arguing on behalf of.
And maybe I'm gonna leave it a little
bit. Stop with they. I'm talking to you. I ain't talking to they. I'm talking to you. I ain't talking to them. Okay, they say, not me. Oh, I can't stand that. And you know what, do you do that with interviews? Do you sit down in your exclusive interviews and be like, well, some people say, like, oh wait, I hate it when reporters hide behind that. Some people say, not me, but some people. What do you say to those people? Shut up. What do you say to those people? Are you one of those people or not?
You do what you got to do to get the answer.
Oh my God, I hate that.
Hey, never say never.
What do you say to the people who say, here's what I say to those people who say, be consistent.
Sounds like a good
Because
question.
If it's all about rings,
that sounds like
if it's all reason. About rings, then I'm not gonna begrudge somebody for what they do to win a ring. If it's all about rings at the end of the day. Now, to segue to this second break of the show, as we go to break, because we'll talk about this guy on the other side. What I will criticize, is how somebody goes about pursuing a championship. I did criticize it for James Harden. Let's talk about James Harden on the other side of the break. The problem with Kevin Durant, though, is remember in 2010 when he was like, everybody want to be on the Lakers or Heat. That tweet's going to follow him.
That was 10 years. That was 11 years ago. That was 11 years ago.
A lot of people keep bringing that up. A lot of people keep bringing
that up. He's evolved, as you said.
They're joining Durant. That's the thing. They're joining Durant. He's not joining them. They're joining him.
He's evolving, though.
Thank you.
Like I am the MVP. It's that simple. I don't want to be, speaking divisionally of myself, but I'm going to just leave it at that. But I just try to go out there every single night and give my teammates everything that I can, bring to the game.
All right, Michael, here we go. James Harden. James Harden scores 44. And he was responding to a question of the league. He was responding. So he says, I feel like I am the MVP. So if you look at it that way, if you look at it in print, and if you see James Harden say it, it's not as offensive. It's not as obnoxious as it reads. Now, the only question I have for James Harden and for you is, I thought Jokic was still playing. He hasn't been hurt. He didn't abandon the Denver Nuggets for 8 games. He's still the best player You're the best player on the team.
Let's just stop right what? There. Let's just cut to the chase. What? Let's just cut to the chase. You don't have to do that. You don't even have to do that. Nope.
Do what?
We could save. Let's save some time.
Do what?
No, let's just get to the point. Let's get to the point. What? Let's just save some time. You don't even have to lay out your case for Nikola Jokic. You don't have to do that.
There's no case.
Y'all don't need to do that.
Here's my case. I'm going to lay out my case for him. He's in the lineup. Period. Okay? He plays. That's my case for him. Look at the guy's season. The guy's playing unbelievable.
Look at Harden's season. Look at Harden's season. Okay.
Great basketball.
Look at Harden's season. Harden's playing historically great basketball. Look at Harden. It's nice. So, Michael, listen. Michael, you had a case.
I didn't come up with those stats. I didn't make
those up. They look pretty comparable to me. They look pretty comparable to me.
They do?
I would expect a big man to shoot a higher field goal percentage.
You shoot 43% from 3-point range? You would?
He takes fewer threes. I ain't got to be a genius to know that.
How about triple doubles? You expect a big man to have 12 triple doubles?
12 to 11, blowout. Oh my God, Michael! You don't have to do that. You don't have to, Michael. You don't have to do this.
Go ahead.
You don't have to do this. You don't have to make a case for Nikola Jokic. Let's focus on your case against James Harden. No, but let's focus on your case against James Harden.
I don't have a case against James Harden.
When it was Joel Embiid. No, yeah, you do.
I don't.
Okay. I'll replace case with bias. Bias. You have something against exactly. Yes. Okay, great. Same thing. Okay, exactly.
Right here.
Yeah, thank you.
Some anti-MVP, like Harden can't win the MVP. He could win the MVP Jokic did retire. Unfortunately, Jokic did. He didn't retire. He's still playing. He's still balling.
Denver is
ascending.
Now you acting. All right. Michael, listen. Michael, I know what it is. It's okay. I know what it is. And you don't have to, you don't have to play games with me. You don't have to play games with me. Okay? Your MVP is Joel Embiid. Unfortunately,
not anymore.
No fault of his own because he's hurt. But if you
out of the running.
If you were arguing with but when Joel Embiid was the MVP, if you wanted to come to me and say, "Michael, Joel Embiid's the MVP because my MVPs need to be dominant at both ends of the floor." My MVPs need to excel at both ends. You'd have the defense argument with Joel Embiid. I don't believe that you can make an airtight argument. I don't believe it. I'd love to hear it, and maybe you can. There is no drop-dead argument for Nikola Jokic over James Harden when it comes to performance on the court. There is none. You can't.
No?
Because Harden is the best player on the best team in basketball.
Wait a minute.
I know you don't agree with that.
Me the best player.
Most people
Whoa. You just told me that Kevin Durant was the best player on any team he's on. You just said that. You said it about 5 minutes ago.
He's been hurt.
Oh,
okay, if you're going to use my words against me, use them properly and use them in context.
No,
if
you're
going to use my words against me, use them properly and in context.
Be a little more careful with your words.
He's hurt. We're having an MVP discussion. We're not having a legacy or ranking discussion.
Kevin Durant is better.
We're having an MVP discussion. If we were ranking the top players in the NBA, Durant still comes before Harden. But we're talking about MVP, okay? If we're ranking the best players in the league, we're talking about LeBron, and we're barely having a conversation beyond that. We're talking about the MVP award, and let's talk about guys that are playing. We could agree on that. You got to play to be the MVP. All right?
I agree.
And Harden, say what you want about him, throughout his career, in the regular season, always shows up. He's the best player on the best team. They don't have the best record, but most people's power rankings.
Well, they're not the best team then.
Include the Brooklyn Nets at the top. Since they've gotten James Harden, they've been the best team.
Best player on the best
team. They've been the best team. Since they got James Harden, they've been the best team. Okay? Having said all of that.
They've had the best record since.
Let's focus
since
on
James
the point.
Got there. Okay.
Let's focus on the point. You want to be the popos when it comes to MVP. You and others like you, y'all feel like y'all gotta police the integrity of the most valuable player award. No. You can't give it to James Harden because of Houston. Just say it.
I can't.
Just admit it. You will not give it to James Harden because of how he left Houston. That's why you won't give it to Harden.
Because I don't like James Harden, homie. I told you that. I'm not a James Harden fan.
Oh, that's worse. Oh, that's worse.
Yeah, it's worse. Right.
Okay, and you think that's a better argument?
Oh, no, it ain't.
You think that's a better argument?
It's not a better argument. I'm being honest. I'm not
certain things you shouldn't be honest about.
No, everything you should be honest about. I'll be honest about everything. And judge me. Go ahead. I'll take the judgment.
Well, that doesn't help you. Okay, go ahead.
I don't need help. I just need to be honest. Hey, I'm not going to hide behind, he was in Houston for 8 games and he didn't play well in Houston, or he let them down. Therefore, he's ineligible for the MVP. He's not ineligible for the MVP. I'm not a big James Harden fan. That's one. But that's not my number one reason. That's probably two. That's two. My number one reason is somebody's playing better. Didn't I do a show with Michael Smith a couple weeks ago? Where Michael Smith just makes this eloquent argument about, hey, you know, it just because you don't get the MVP doesn't mean that you're not playing well. You just happen to play well in a season where somebody played better. Well, guess what? Somebody's playing better than James Harden. He's in Denver. You see him every night. Jokic is playing better and more consistently.
Hey, can I go? Go ahead. Finish that. More consistently all year. As in Houston. As in the 8 games he's in Houston. Well, because he's not been better than James Harden since Harden got to Brooklyn.
Let's leave the word Houston out of it. You just said all year. Okay, let's go game logs. Okay, from game one to the present. Okay.
When he was in Houston.
I'm going to talk my way out of this. Yes, I am. If you go game logs.
Come on, dog. Like, come on. I mean, Michael. Just embrace that. You a hater, dog. Embrace it. It's cool.
Yeah.
I love you.
I told you that.
I love you regardless. Bruh.
I told you.
You the problem. Do you have an MVP vote? Do you have a most valuable player vote?
Ooh, I used to. I used to have one.
Did they take it from you? Not a moment too soon. Thank God you don't have an MVP vote. Because, dog.
Hey, I had one.
Bruh. Michael, if you would have said, let me say something for you. Let me say something on your behalf. This just because I don't believe you. I don't believe you. I'm channeling my inner Alonzo. I don't believe you. I don't believe that you really feel strongly that Nikola Jokic has been better than James Harden. I don't believe that. I think you would take anybody over James Harden at this point. I think you're incapable of recognizing James Harden's greatness, because if you go back to preseason, you don't like James Harden, which frankly, my friend, is the worst argument I've ever heard. If your argument against James Harden's MVP candidacy is I don't like James Harden, I would prefer that you said, I mean, for whatever it's worth, I know you don't care what I prefer, but it would have come off better, respectfully. And you would have said, I can't get over how he destroyed the Rockets. I can't get over how he intentionally tanked to force a trade. I don't know what that means. I don't. Chapstick? Do I need chapstick? What does that mean?
No, what is this?
Cap? Nope. That's no cap. Cap. No cap. How can your argument against James Harden be, I don't like James Harden? Like, come on, man. He's leading the league in assists.
Okay. I'm not an MVP.
He's been holding it down with Kevin Durant on the sideline and Kyrie Irving on sabbatical half the time.
You know what?
I mean, what more do
when
you
I covered
want
the league,
man?
When I covered the league, I was more objective. Or I tried to. I gave the illusion of trying to be objective. I actually worked at it. Now that I don't have to cover the NBA, I can watch a game and I don't have to think about, hey, what's my league going to be? Who am I going to talk to in the locker room? What's my next day story? I don't have to worry about all that. I can just let my worst instincts take over. So there are some players you like and some players you're not really a fan of. I'm not really a fan of the thing. I don't like the James Harden thing. I just don't like it. James Harden experience is not.
James Harden thing?
It's not. The James Harden experience is not for me. It's not for me.
You know what?
But that Jokic.
This experience is not for me. I'm gonna phone a friend. I'm gonna phone a friend.
That Jokic.
I need help. Because at a certain sometimes when couples and partners where they having it out, sometimes you just need to get a fresh voice. You need a fresh perspective. You need a fresh take. Maybe you've tuned me out. And I wouldn't blame you. A lot of people have. Maybe you've tuned me out by now. So I think I'm going to phone a friend, and we're going to bring in, for the first time on Brother from Another, we're about to class up the joint, okay? I'm about to hit up Monica McNutt on FaceTime.
Yes.
To help me. How are you? It is so nice to see you. Thank you for gracing our show with your presence. I know you've been listening to this nonsense. The floor is yours. Please talk some sense into my man. Please.
Hi, guys. Well, it's super exciting to be here. What's up? What's up? What's up? Now,
What's up, Monica?
What's going on?
Holly, to your point, I am struggling to give James Harden my MVP nod too, but not for your reasons. NFL season, people came at my neck when I said Patrick Mahomes should be the MVP, and we cannot allow Patrick Mahomes to be LeBron James in terms of we take advantage of his greatness, right? But everybody wanted to say, what's my man in Green Bay? Aaron Rodgers has done more with less, right? So, in the grand scheme of things, considering where the Nuggets are, I would argue, it's a slight argument, it's a petite argument, but I would argue that the Joker is doing more with less, because I'm struggling to give James Harden my nod knowing he got all that firepower on his roster. I know the numbers are the numbers, but that's where I'm at on the argument.
Well, I like it.
What firepower? They ain't been playing on... You like it. Durant ain't playing.
I do like
it. Kyrie in and out. Jamal Murray's a bum all of a sudden? They didn't just acquire Aaron Gordon?
Okay, they just acquired just Aaron Gordon. Yes, that's him. True. And Jamal Murray Jamal Murray hasn't been necessarily what we saw from the bubble last year. And I get it. KD and Kyrie, they in and out, blah, blah, blah. But in my mind, that roster is still super loaded, and it's not fair.
Oh, okay. Now the truth comes out. That last part is critical, and it's not fair. Why is it so you one of these, like, you know, where's basketball reasons? Where's the late David Stern when you need him, people? Is this out of control? This stacked Nets team, you got a problem with it, Monica?
I'm taking the day to, you know what I'm saying, voice all my grievances. I'm giving myself 24 hours, then I'm gonna move on from it, Smith. But like this stacked phenomenon, I will never begrudge players handling their business. They got to do what they got to do. But I'm not going to lie, at a certain point, it's like, come on, y'all. Come on, y'all.
I love it.
Does this stacked phenomenon, does this only apply to Brooklyn at this point? Because what Michael Holly has not brought up in this entire show, but I'm going to introduce it now. Maybe the best player in the buyout market is with the Lakers.
Yeah.
I mean, I would prefer Andre Drummond over LaMarcus Aldridge or Blake Griffin at this point. Oh, because the Lakers need the help.
They need the help. Oh, you know, LeBron's out, AD out. They need some assistance. But you know, Monica, if you look at the NBA landscape, if you look at the total NBA landscape outside of Brooklyn, and we've talked about them enough. This is the most I've talked about James Harden in my life. Oh, this is awful. But if you look at them outside of Brooklyn, the league, is there a team that intrigues you? And if so, why?
All right. So I said this morning, actually. I'm starting to become more and more intrigued with the Bucks. And I know they typically flame out in the playoffs. Giannis is MVPs. They get blown away, like whatever. But I think this year we started to see them try to do something different. And I will admit, I was of the crew that's like, what's going on with the Bucks initially, especially on the first half of the season before we got to All-Star break. At points, they seemed disinterested. I thought they were dropping games that they shouldn't have. Now, Jrue Holiday wasn't necessarily healthy through the entire run. But I'm wondering if, in their mind, some of this conservation of energy, if you'll allow me to use that term, is going to benefit them in the long run. Because I think they've seen, you know, the regular season means nothing. Great, we had this wonderful record. But when it matters, we couldn't put up. I think they've been on a tear as of late. I'm just curious to see if it bears fruit. But the firepower in Brooklyn, man, like, I really feel like the East is the Nets to lose.
Ooh, thank you. I was hoping that we would arrive at agreement at some point, Monica. I brought you on. I thought you were going to be on Team Smith when it came to this Harden thing. So I'm glad you said that. I want to take a break. Before we do, I want to get your take on one other thing that we were talking about related to Brooklyn, if we can go back to the Nets for a second, is do you find Kevin Durant to be too sensitive, or is he just that comfortable in his own skin to where he doesn't care how he comes off with these Twitter back and forths?
I'm going to go with the latter. I think it's entertaining, personally. If he is sensitive, he has achieved a level of success that, you know, we can't touch in terms of basketball. Right? If that's who he is, then that's who he is. You know what I mean? I think the idea of policing athletes and, oh, you don't need to respond to them. At no point has him responding to any Twitter troll affected his play. So when he goes and lays an egg, having gone back and forth with, you know, faceless egg on Twitter, then talk to me. But until then, like, that's the man's thing. All right, cool.
Indeed. Agreed. All right. So, Monica, we haven't even touched the NCAA tournaments yet. Can you hang around with us for a second? And let's come back and let's talk about quick these break. Elite Eight
it's
matchups.
Really quick.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really quick. Like, quicker than
our you breaks are super like, quick.
Yeah. It's like non-existent practically. But we got to take them. All right. So we'll be right back with the great Monica McNutt. Plus, we got to get into your story. Got to get into, like, just your rise. It's been super impressive. So we appreciate you joining us.
Look, there's really no other way for me to say it. You're missing out. If you're not playing this, you're missing out. It's the free contest on the NBC Sports Predictor app. They've already handed out over 3 million in cash prizes, and there are tens of thousands more up for grabs this and every week. So get in on the action right now with the NBC Sports Predictor app powered by PointsBet.
All right. Hey, the NCAA tournament, we are on the verge of finding out what's going on. One of the greatest weekends in sports, that whole Final Four weekend leading to the national championship game. And no surprise, Michael Smith and Monica McNutt still alive. We don't know what's going to happen in the Elite Eight, but we still have three number one seeds alive. With the possibility of making it to the Final Four. I don't want to say I told you so. There are some great moments that I've enjoyed from this tournament, but I wouldn't say it's the most unpredictable tournament with three number one seeds with the opportunity to go to the Final Four. It's hilarious. See, I told you. You try to go at me, Mike Smith, like, oh, did you see Oral Roberts? You see Oral 15 beating the two? Okay, great. That's nice. But that usually doesn't translate to a Final Four appearance. Anyway, Monica, I don't want to get into my little fights with Michael Smith. Anything from the NCAA tournament that has gotten your attention?
Oh, man. Okay. So I guess in this latest round, I'm really impressed with Oregon State and Wayne Tinkle. I think that this team, the entire story for them, to be picked bottom of the Pac-12, get the AQ by winning their Pac-12 tournament, and then just to be playing so well. I was having this conversation with a friend the other day, and we were talking about how systemically, in terms of what they do, they're kind of zigging while everybody else is zagging. They've got big dudes. I think I was looking at the box score the other night. Nobody that played is less than 6'3". They got a 7'1 dude. They rebound the basketball tremendously. They hit timely shots. I mean, they've really been the wild card, and I've been really enjoying their run. I will say, Gonzaga, I'm not high on Creighton, to be fair. But the way Gonzaga dismantled Creighton this recent round, I was like, "Ooh, this!" I wasn't in on them being the Indiana 76 Hoosiers all over again. In fact, I got Gonzaga Baylor in my final, giving the edge to Baylor. But that team is very, very good.
So I'm thinking about just going with this Pac-12 theme that we got going here. I was actually thinking of, you know, I don't usually do this. But I'm thinking about picking USC over Gonzaga. I'm thinking like the move might be going with Oregon State, going with Gonzaga. And dare I say it, I love Michigan, love Juwan Howard. Listen, man, we've seen a first 14 do this before. I might even take UCLA. The Pac-12 is not to be trifled with in this tournament. So I'm actually thinking USC given the NBA caliber talent that they have on the team, I'm actually thinking USC might be the one to upset Gonzaga, if you could call that an upset.
Okay. I will say that I covered Mick Cronin in his Cincinnati days, and he had some blue-collar, like, get-up-in-your-face, chip-on-our-shoulder, everybody-counted-us-out squads. And there are shades of this to that UCLA team. Quite honestly, though, if Alabama hits free throws, like, this is, of course, looking at the box score, right? You can't necessarily have revisionist history.
Yeah, yeah.
But Alabama's Achilles heel yesterday legit was those free throws. Not that UCLA didn't play well, but your star and Juzang can't foul out. Like, that's an issue. There's a grit about Mick Cronin teams that I don't think is too wild to see them getting the upset. I think Michigan minus Livers is still an issue. But the USC-Gonzaga deal, I will say this. Position by position in terms of your backcourt, or your frontcourt rather, Timmy and Mobley, like, you got to give the edge to Mobley. With either one,
I would honestly, say so.
Right? And then I think if you go guard to guard, I mean, Suggs is fantastic, but USC's guards are not necessarily sleepers either. I will be curious to see how Gonzaga responds if this USC team has an opportunity to punch them in the mouth and get them on the mat, for sure.
You know, Monica, of the three of us, I think only one of us played college basketball. I think that's the case. And I see a basketball.
Does intramural count?
No, does not count.
Does intramural count?
No.
Okay. All right.
No.
Okay.
And I see that ball up there behind you. It's got your name on it. See, I got basketballs with other people's names on it, but not my own. So I know you played. And so, first of all, because I have a question related to being a college athlete. But just tell us a little bit about, you know, Mike said during the break, hey, we want to talk about you a little bit and your story. You know, tell us about your evolution from college basketball player to media personality.
Oh, man, guys. All right, so I hooped at Georgetown Hoya Saxa. This year was, I meant Georgetown, yeah, we in there. This year, obviously, was super special in terms of what the guys were able to pull off at the Big East tournament. But I kind of remember just being like, I love this, and I'm not going to go to the WNBA, and I don't want to be an ocean away if I'm going to start a career in media. And so right after school, I started in different capacities. I did get my journalism degree from the University of Maryland because I did not want to be boxed in just as a women's basketball analyst. I wanted to be able to show up with a notepad or camera or whatever it may be and tell the tremendous stories of athletes. So fast forward, I finished my graduate program in 2013. So fast forward close to 10 years, I graduated in 2011. And here we are. And I think the funny thing is, and you guys probably can appreciate this, I know the arc of your stories are tremendous. I remember graduating in 2011, and people that I loved, these weren't even yet industry people, but said, what are you going to do about your hair if you want to be on TV? And I was like, nothing? Like, here I am. And so I cannot say forthright whether part of the speed of my journey has had to do with my hair and my look and all that. But you guys know television is a subjective medium, but it is something that I was not willing to give on. And so I'm thrilled to be here now, having abundance of opportunities with the lipstick, the earrings, the hair. Here we go.
Love it. Yeah, be authentic,
to be
you.
Here and your,
yeah.
Being your, here in your full self. That's what's important. Not just here, but here as your full self. I want to get into the women's bracket. But I do want to follow up.
Oh, go ahead, go ahead.
Unless you got a follow up to Michael.
I
was just going to say because that you that was the Cliff Notes version of your journey. But you were laid off what twice in like what 18 months or 2 years or something like that. So it has not been you are not an overnight success. And I would love to know now that more and more people are paying attention, some of these opportunities are coming through. Can you compare? Like, you know, I know it's not lost on you what it took to get here. Can you compare how you're feeling now with, you know, I guess, what would you have told yourself as you were going through it? What were those struggles like? What were those setbacks like? And now that you're on the other side of it and still ascending, I guess, you know, what would you have told yourself as you were going through that, if that makes sense?
You know, Mike, and not to toot my own horn, but I'm a journaler. And I do this thing where sometimes I
put
like a journal, right? And I'll be like, yes, girl, you did that. You hung in there. You lived that. You walked that out, right? And so I'm pleased to say that there's really not much I would have told myself because to me it was just continuing to move forward. The layoffs for me were so instrumental because it allowed me to separate who I am from what I do. And you guys know, we are literally so intertwined with what we do as media members. It can be very hard to disassociate your value in terms of the paycheck that you earn and just who you are. And so those were very formative seasons in my life when I didn't have the job and wasn't sure if it was going to come back. I legit was about to go teach English and do this on the side as a hustle. And then your girl Jamel and Maria were two people, Maria Taylor, were two people in particular that encouraged me to keep going. And so now, as I'm ascending, and don't get me wrong, I'm having a blast, right? There is a part of me that's kind of like, yeah. Oh, welcome to the party. I've been here, right? But in the same breath, right. I don't have the attachment that I think I would have had I not been laid off, right? I'm enjoying it. We're going to milk the season for everything that it's worth. But at the same time, there is a world in which I see myself, for whatever reason, being able to step away while others might see, you know, you've just hit your prime or your stride, because there's so much more to who I am.
I love that. I love that. Yeah. Gave you perspective.
We talk about that. I mean, this is what we talk about on the show, just really. And you mentioned Mike, and when he was working with Jamel on ESPN, on the air, on TV, their podcast, you know, that was really part of their draw, that you could just tell that it was genuine. And it wasn't just about, hey, here are these personalities. Here are these people who are just bringing it to you in a real way. And that's what we try to do here, too. And we start off today, Monica, talking about the trial in Minnesota. Derek Chauvin, however you pronounce his last name. And I said, today, I've just been a little uneasy with this whole trial. How has it hit you? And are you paying attention to it in any special way today, or were you doing it last week or a couple of weeks before that?
You know, Holly, I will admit that I have not paid special attention to it, because this country has let us down repeatedly, right? And so as disappointing and gut-wrenching it is to have that sentiment, I'm not expecting much. And I think 2020 as a summer may be, and hear me when I say this, the only silver lining, if I can use that word, that came out of COVID, is because people had to sit with themselves and acknowledge and see. And the demonstrations were powerful. And I do think there were some very fruitful conversations. But in general, anytime you see, you know, corporations dropping the black grid on Instagram, oh, this thing has gone commercial. Like, we've lost it, right? And so yep. I have not been paying close attention to this. I mean, I follow reputable news outlets on my timeline, and there are certain people that I will tap in to see what the latest reports are, but I can't say that I've been giving it any special attention, because I quite honestly don't have very high hopes.
Well said. We bounced around, which is what we should do. But we got to talk about the ladies. We got away from the tournament, but we only talked about one half. And in no way are we trying to perpetuate the notion that the ladies are in any way an afterthought when it comes to March Madness. They're not. Now, having said that, which actually dovetails right into something I wanted to point out, because obviously we all know that the budget for the men's tournament, it was astronomical compared to the women's tournament. We saw the controversy about the difference in amenities, whether it's the weight room, whether it's the gift bags, whether it's COVID testing, whether it's the meals. A lot of different conversation about that leading up to the tournaments, obviously. But something that Axial Sports put out today, which I found quite interesting, wanted to draw to your attention. Did you see this?
I did see this. This is great. Go ahead.
Yeah, I saw it too.
This is great. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So this is about name, image, and likeness rights. Obviously, that's, you know, coming to a head. Hopefully there'll be some legislation that allows athletes to monetize it. But basically, among the men's and women's Elite Eight teams, 8 of the 10 most followed players and 10 of the top 20 are women. Paige Beckers at the top of the list with a combined 730,000 Instagram and Twitter followers. Haley Van Lith from Louisville with 696. I mean, the list goes on and on, where the women are the most popular, if you go off Instagram and Twitter followers, by far and away more popular than the men, at least among the top 10. I guess, simply put, Monica, what does that say?
All right, two things. I'm going to jump into my little helpful producer friend of the show hat. Y'all got to get Sig Coulson and Chloe Pavlik on this show, and I'm going to explain to you why. Chloe has been a big part of the boom in social media when it comes to women's basketball. And so she can speak to the relationships that she has with these girls. And then the other, Sydney's just hilarious. Like, she's going to be an actor when she finishes playing basketball. But this weekend, she literally posted, shout out to all the cute girlies. If you guys have seen the tournaments, the girls are there with their edges laid, like the lashes are super long, their faces are
nails big. And whatnot.
Exactly. Yeah. So she says, shout out to all the cute girlies. And Sydney and I are about the same age. Because when we hooped, and this is so true, y'all, we used to show up so dusty. Like, I legit remember rolling out of bed from our pregame nap. Like, yeah, we about to go play ball. Like, no big deal. Anyway, I say all of that to say the girls have been very deliberate in monetizing, or I shouldn't say monetizing, but in using this platform because they didn't necessarily have the exposure that the guys had. And so now, on the flip side, there's this whole new world in which they are at the front of this movement in terms of athletes being able to monetize. And so it's really incredible to see. I applaud Paige and Haley because they've come in with a social media interest and following that we haven't really seen in the women's game. And I think social media has been huge in elevating both the women's college game and at the WNBA level, quite honestly.
And what did you, that's a great point. I love that insight there. What did you think? I know everybody's talked about it. The weight room pictures that went around, the food, the COVID testing. And I know a lot of coaches were being diplomatic saying, hey, this is what we've been trying to tell you, but we're hopeful that things will turn around. Let's be a little more raw with it. What was your top of mind thought when you saw the pictures and you heard the conversation?
So, Holly, my first thought, without comparing to the men's facility, was what elite athletes are training here, period, right? And so I think the comparison exacerbated the issue, but I was like, what is going on, right? And it's that experience was really unique for me. I was in studio with ESPN for opening weekend. So we were getting multiple sides of this conversation. You could hop on social media, your favorite professional athlete, or an amateur athlete, rather. Sedona Prince's piece is going viral. So many people chiming in. And then we had the incredible Holly Rowe, who's like reporting from the ground. And so are there some things in there that could be massaged? You know, if you blame the food on the hotel and the hotel staff immediately got with team nutritionists and tried to write the food piece and the picture that you saw of the men's food, there's no such thing as buffets in COVID anymore. That was a fake photo. The NCAA had planned to provide the women with the weight rooms at the round of 3-16. I'm questioning why we needed to wait to the round of 3-16. And of course, since then, there's been a tremendous amount of reporting and acknowledgement of the disparities in budgets. But I honestly, guys, had to take a moment for myself and think, if I had been there, would I have posted that? And from what I understand, Sedona Prince of Oregon, whose video went most viral, was nervous about it. But there is this sentiment of be grateful that you're here and understand all that we took to get here this year. But I sort of applaud the young women, not sort of, but I do applaud the women for saying I can be grateful and also expect more. And I think that is where this generation is moving in terms of, no, we're not going to settle for less because in your mind, the men's teams are the generators of the income and revenue. No, we're here. And if this NCAA body is truly designed to serve all athletes in 26 sports or whatever the number is, then no, I'm not just going to show up and be grateful. You're going to treat me like an elite athlete because that's what I am.
And let's close this out by acknowledging their elite athleticism that has been on display and not simply reduce a women's basketball conversation. Not that obviously you guys are doing this, so I'll make sure we say this, not reduce a women's basketball conversation to a juxtaposition with the men's game and to controversy. Like, they've been hooping, Monica. That's they've been, as right. you know, I mean, like, this weekend, the game of the weekend was Beckers versus Clark. And Aaliyah Edwards was like, yo, I'm out here too now. Aaliyah Edwards was like, yo, I'm here. Like this ain't just a two player show.
Let me call Mike out real quick because, you know, going into the weekend, he told me to take Iowa.
Okay, yeah.
Over UConn.
Stop it. Okay, fine.
Like, okay. What?
You gotta.
What?
Bruh, stop bringing up old stuff. Just because. Okay, sorry. I went with Caitlin Clark. God forbid. And both of us were wrong because Aaliyah Edwards was the best player on the court. Thank you very much. Meanwhile, yeah. You got the presumptive number one pick in Texas. you know, like, that's not an upset. You can't have upset when you got the presumptive number one pick in the WNBA draft, but Texas moves on. I want to take a look at your bracket and tell me who you got on the women's side. I know you said you had Baylor and Gonzaga for the men, with the Baylor winning the championship. Who you like in the Elite Eight to come out of the women's side of the bracket?
So everything has been perfect so far, guys, except, Mike, I got to get you, because Texas beating Maryland was an upset, particularly for me, because I had Maryland
based on seed.
Listen, but not just based on seed, though, Mike, because Maryland had been hanging out in the top 10 all season long. And I will say that we love the new level of parity coming to the game of women's basketball on the college level. Texas had kind of been in and out of the top 25. I'm an AP voter. They were hanging around in the 20s. And then down the stretch of the season, they had fallen out of the rankings. So this indeed, yes, by seed was an upset. And I think if you didn't follow Big 12 basketball specifically, it was also an upset. I will say, Vic Schaefer,
okay,
mastermind. Like, fair mastermind. Enough. And you got my tweet right there. We're talking about the Texas defense, but what they were able to do offensively to me, taking the air out of the ball, being incredibly patient. They got super timely offensive boards. Maryland, you got to understand, Maryland is a team that puts up 91 points, like, on the regular. And you held them to the 60s? This was really impressive. I'm excited for their next round matchup. And yeah, I don't know why. Who picked Iowa over UConn? Like, Caitlin and Paige are one and the same team.
Okay, so no, but who you got? Thank you for schooling me on Texas.
Yeah, Maryland, who's going to win the whole thing?
I got to recalibrate because I had Maryland. I guess I really like what this Baylor squad is doing. I know that they got to get through UConn. I think that's a tough matchup for UConn because Baylor is so athletic at every position and they get up and down the floor. If Kristen Williams and Aaliyah Edwards play the way that they played in their most recent game, though, that could change the dynamic. That just has not been them consistently throughout the duration of the season.
Yeah.
So I really like what Baylor has going. They are the defending champions. But then you can't sleep on Stanford. Stanford is a team to me that doesn't have any weaknesses, and they were battle-tested by not being able to compete in their home arena due to COVID protocols for like 2 months at the beginning of the season.
So that's sick 'em on both sides then. You got the Bears winning a minute.
How about that?
Sound like,
that would be good. Okay. That's happened before.
That's a heck of a story. All right. Hey, listen, thank you for coming through. Thank you for grace. It was a pleasure. Hopefully the first of many. And I love what you said. Like, you ain't getting caught up in this. You know, you've seen the other side, and you got some serious perspective as you rise in this game. Well, it's a pleasure to have you on, Monica McNutt, and we'll be continuing following your career, following on your commentary. Come back again. Kick it with us another time.
For sure. Thanks, guys.
Please do.
All right.
Take it. All right, Monica. Good stuff. Great stuff.
I've watched their tape and stuff. I've got a chance to watch a lot of, everybody, but 49ers specifically. Obviously, they run a lot of wide zone. They also have a great fullback, so they can run power, and they do a bunch of good play pass off of that. So outside zone, sprint out stuff. Obviously, their drop back passing game is really similar to what we did with Sark, and, you know, some of their motions that they use. I noticed they got the boomerang motions and the cat motions across the ball fast. So that's all stuff that I'm really familiar with. And obviously, it's a super quarterback-friendly offense, and they have great playmakers there. So I'm really looking forward to just learning more about that.
You still don't think it was for a quarterback, Michael Holly?
Dang! Yo! Yo!
I mean, I've seen Sim say it. I've seen Sim
My
say
man.
It. I've seen Daniel Jeremiah say it.
Woo.
At NFL Network. The sense is, people are saying.
Some people
that
say
not only are they going up for a quarterback, but specifically it is for Mac Jones at the number 3 pick. So you were pretty adamant on Friday that it wasn't for a quarterback. You still on that?
I'll say this. Mac Jones deserves to be taken in the top 5. I'm a Mac Jones fan, and it's just amazing to me. It's amazing to me that it has taken this long to get to this point. I knew it would come, but I didn't think it would come a month before the draft. I mean, it really should have happened right after the season. The guy leads an undefeated SEC team to the national championship. He completes 77% of his passes in the it's either all SEC or playoff games. 77% of his passes. And that's a problem? I mean, of course he's a baller. Of course he's dope. But that being said, I love Mac Jones, and I think he will go in the top five. I don't know if we go to San Francisco. The brilliance of San Francisco's move, Mike, is that they can do anything. And wouldn't you just love it? This is what I would do if I were San Francisco. Yeah, I'd let people speculate all day long. Hey, Chris Sims, you think we're taking Mac Jones? I'm not going to take him. We're not. Daniel Jeremiah, Adam Schefter, Peter King, whatever. Go ahead. Say we're taking a quarterback. And if you call me and you talk about a quarterback, I'm just going to nod. They are in a beautiful position to throw a curveball if they got a curveball. If they got a curveball in the back pocket, this is a great time to take it. They can take the best. If they don't think the best player on the board is Trevor Lawrence or Zach Wilson, if they don't think that, they can take the highest rated person on the board.
So it sounds like you're still not convinced.
I'm not convinced. Absolutely
Dude,
not.
You're stubborn.
Okay,
you
no, it's not stubborn.
Pay
Mike,
that kind of premium for
listen
a
to me.
Receiver.
I am not trying to be right. What I'm telling you is, and look, if it's Mac Jones, great. I'm a Mac Jones fan. What I'm telling you is, people lie at draft time, and they should. They should lie at draft time because you're building a franchise. Two, I don't know what San Francisco's board is. Their top five. Let's say they're top five, just theoretically. I don't know.
Right.
Let's say your top five players on your board. Let's go back to Madden ratings again. Let's say Trevor Lawrence is a 77. Let's say Zach Wilson's a 78. Got to be Trevor Lawrence. And that Kyle Pitts is an 87. Are you just gonna ignore that and say, well, we gotta get a quarterback? Even though we say we're sticking with Jimmy Garoppolo for 2021 and then 22, maybe. Really?
Is the disconnect between the two of us, do you think higher of Jimmy Garoppolo than I do? Is that maybe what it is? Do you think that they have a quarterback and they should build around him?
I think they have a decent quarterback. I don't think he's great.
A long-term quarterback? Oh, he'd have to be top five.
Well, they don't.
Long-term quarterback? Clearly they don't. That's what I'm saying. It's like, Michael, you could love Kyle Pitts. You could love Jamar Chase. You could love a position player. Mike, you don't do that for you don't go up to three, especially when everybody knows that these quarterbacks are going to come off quickly.
You just never do it.
Rarely. Very rarely. Very, very rarely. Has there been a trade up for two first-round picks, two future first-round picks? I don't count the one that you're swapping. I'm not of the opinion that it's not three first-round picks because you're moving from 12 to 3. So that's the one right there. It's right. Two first-round picks and a third. You don't do that. You don't pay that price to move up to get.
But just so we're clear, if the next Lawrence Taylor is there, you do it. If the next Aaron Donald was there, you do it, right? Next Jerry Rice, you do it.